Hey guys, it's Abby. Welcome back to my channel. In today's video, I am going to be showing you 21 terrifying TikToks. Some of these TikToks are absolutely insane. Obviously, I think the TikToks in today's video is my favorite lineup of TikToks that I've done a video on thus far. There's just so many good options in this one, including a guy claiming that his grandfather is the Zodiac Killer. Like, when I tell you, my jaw was dropped. For most of these, I'm not kidding. And I would also like to say a thank you for those of you who did tag me in some of these. If you guys come across a terrifying TikTok that you would like for me to include in my next one of these, feel free to tag me. My links are down below. I will save it and put it in a folder to use for next time. And as always, if you guys like this video, please be sure to give it a big thumbs up. Click the subscribe button down below and turn my post notifications so you never miss a video. I post every Sunday and sometimes Wednesdays at 2 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. And other than that, let's just get right on into the video. Our first TikTok is by the user The Nickel Tree. She is from New Orleans and she has businesses relating to parties and weddings. And she shares a story about one time when she has her son helping her deliver flowers to a bride at this one hotel. They go to the hotel and they click the button to go up to the 14th floor. The doors open and they realize that all the signs say 13. They're not really sure what's going on because they were supposed to be on the 14th floor. They try to talk to a maid who says absolutely nothing to them. They get back on the elevator, press the 14th floor again. The doors close and open back up without moving. And suddenly they are on the 14th floor. They go to deliver flowers and then they get back on the elevator and there's a man there wearing like an old timey kind of uniform. They think maybe there's something going on there. I mean, it's New Orleans, like there's lots of stuff going on all the time. They mentioned to the man that they had a weird experience where it took them to the 13th floor instead of the 14th floor. And the man says, this building does not have a 13th floor. When they go to get off the elevator, she goes to turn around and say something to him, and he is no longer there.
Here's a story that no one asked me to tell. So I'm from, born and bred here in New Orleans, and I've always had my businesses in New Orleans. Mainly, the main parts of the different businesses that I've had focus on events and weddings. So probably around 2003, my son Joey was in high school, and we were doing like over 300 weddings a year, designing flowers and events. So we had to split up into teams to make these deliveries with bouquets. So downtown, as everybody knows, they have different hotels. They're like, oh, that hotel's haunted or this hotel's haunted. Honestly, I was too tired and too busy to even worry about it. But I do have a little bit of clairvoyance. My son Joey, he doesn't, okay? He doesn't believe in anything. So, like his dad. So we were the team that day to go to this hotel. We walk in, we get on the elevator, girls on the 14th floor. No problem. We press 14, we go up, we're like, oh, this is gonna be easy. We're no wait. So we get up to the 14th floor, ding, 14. We get off the elevator and we're walking down the hallway. And it says 1325, 1327, 1329. And I see these steps like ahead, down way down the hallway. I'm like, gosh, maybe we go up the steps and that leads to the 14th floor. We don't know what's going on. So we see a lady folding towels. This little lady, short black hair, a little uniform on. She looked like she was about to go and clean one of the rooms. We're on our way back from going down that hall and still all 1300s. We go up to her and start talking to her and say, hey, what's going on? Like, where do we go? Which way leads to the 14th floor? And this lady, it was like she was seeing through us. She was not paying attention to us. She didn't look at us. It was like she was a guest. So he and I look at each other and he's like, I'm leaving. Okay. I don't know what's going on, but I'm getting back on that elevator. We go back on the elevator. We press 14 again. Okay. The door closes. We press 14. The door opens back up. We walk out and here's the room numbers, 1425, 1427. And he and I are like shaking. So we go deliver the flowers to the bride. We don't say a word. We don't say a word because right now we're thinking, okay, we don't know what just happened. So we deliver the flowers. We get back on the elevator and there's this man standing in the corner and he looks like he has like an older uniform on, maybe from the early 1900s. And we're like, oh, there must be something going on. You know, I mean, this is the French Quarter. So, I mean, all kind of like festivals and all kind of stuff going. So we look at him and we're like, hey, what's up with the floors here. We were just on the 13th floor. This man looks straight ahead and he says, this hotel doesn't have a 13th floor. And Joey and I look at each other. We get to the bottom floor. We walk off that elevator. I look back and that man wasn't there. And from that time on, my son Joey will not go in that hotel. As a matter of fact, he doesn't even like it when I tell the story. He won't even tell the story because he doesn't want to believe that that happened, but he knows it did. So that's my story for today.
The fact that so many like subtly paranormal things happened in such a short period of time between it taking them to supposedly the wrong floor. I don't even know what you call that. It's like, they'd be like how, it's like some kind of a trick of the eye. Cause obviously the elevator didn't move once they got back on, they were on the 14th floor. But the fact that all the signs had 13, absolutely crazy. Them speaking to the maid and her just like looking straight through them. To me, that is like residual energy of some kind. It's not like an intelligent spirit. It's just, you know, energy. It's probably just like a spirit in the zone of like their typical patterns of like cleaning rooms, where it's just going back and forth and going in a loop is essentially what that to me seems like. And then the man telling them there is no 13th floor, and then disappearing. That's a whole lot of paranormal activity for one hotel. One trip to a hotel, that's a lot. And I've said this in another video, but it really says a lot when someone who is not a believer is so frightened that they don't even want to speak about it again. That's how you know it's real. I personally have never been to New Orleans, but I would love to go just for the sole purpose of going on ghost tours. I think it would be fascinating, although I don't think I'd be able to sleep for like a month afterwards because I'd be so afraid that I brought something home with me. Our next TikTok is by the user Hey Vanabitha. She tells us a story that is actually her friend's story about a time she's hiking the Appalachian Trail. Craziest things are always happening in Appalachia, apparently. While she's out there by herself, she makes friends with a man named Dave, who ends up asking her to watch his house while he has to go out of town. He introduces her to an old man named Bob and says that if she has any issues to call him and he will help. Pipes end up bursting in Dave's house, so she calls Bob. She ends up spending quite a bit of time with Bob. They're hanging out, they're becoming pals, and when Dave comes back, they end up deciding to smoke weed together. But Bob has been acting weird. He keeps knocking over wine and talking about murdering people and starts talking about how he did it and how he hid it and all of this other kind of crazy stuff to the point where the girl gets really freaked out and Dave, who knows and trusts Bob, is freaked out and realizes that this man is admitting to crimes. But when they try to go to the police do not believe them.
Put a finger down if your best friend told you she was going to hike the entire Appalachian Trail by herself and it was going to take months. And along the way, she makes a group of trail friends. One of them we'll call Dave. Halfway through the trail, Dave asks her if she'll come and look after his house in Vermont because he has to go to Belgium with his family, who had up until that point been looking after his house. She agrees because she wants a break. They go to Vermont. He introduces her to Bob before he leaves. Bob is an old man and a farmer who's a very close family friend to Dave's family. Built the house he lives in and tells her, if anything goes wrong, you call Bob. The day that Dave leaves, his pipes burst and his basement floods. So my friend has to call Bob. Bob comes and fix it, starting a friendship. My friend begins going over there in the evenings for dinner because she's in a new town, she doesn't know anybody, and she's lonely and making friends with this sweet old man, Bob, who has fantastic stories and is absolutely lovely to her. Then Dave returns from Belgium and they start hanging out with Bob together. They decide to stay one more week in Vermont. They go over there one night and they offer Bob some. After he partakes, he starts acting a little bit weird, then asks them if they want wine, then brings them wine, pours all three of them glasses, but knocks his over accidentally, but really obviously on purpose, and does this three times. Then all of a sudden brings up how when he was 12, his grandfather told him that he needed to unalive the farmhand because he was staring at his sister wrong, and to also unalive his dog, and makes him dig a grave, burying the handyman, and then the dog on top, so that if anybody gets suspicious and starts digging, they find a dog and they stop and go, oh, it's just a dog. Then your friend starts to freak out, but Dave, knowing him, doesn't freak out at all until he says, do you want to see the skull? Then Bob runs up to the house, which is sectioned into two pieces. One half is lived in and one half is claimed to be condemned with a collapsed floor where no one's allowed to go in it because it's super not safe. He runs to that side of the house and comes back out with a skull with no teeth and throws it to Dave like a basketball. Then Dave asks why it didn't have any teeth and he says because none of them have any teeth, and then asks them if you want to see a CIA-issued weapon, then runs back up to the same side of the house that he said is condemned and unsafe and brings back a large velvet box where, when opened, you see a weapon that is not CIA-issued but instead definitely handmade with no serial number. Bob then claims that the gun fall apart after being shot 3 or 4 times so that it can't be traced. Then goes on to mention other bodies and ask them if they want to see where it's buried. Then when he runs back up to the condemned part of the house to get more skulls, Dave looks at your friend and says, "Something's going on, follow my lead, we have to go." When he comes back, they talk their way out of it and say they have to go, but they're very visibly freaked out. He insists that they stay the night, insists, but they leave. Instead of going home, they go to Dave's mom's house, where she's very mad that this random girl and her son have shown up after midnight unannounced. He then starts crying to his mom in French, so your friend can't understand anything they're saying, but when they're done, she speaks English and says, "You're just and drunk, and you have no idea what you're talking about. You're insane." Next day, your friend and Dave are still upset about it, and they go back to his house where all the doors are open and the indoor cat only is outside. And there's a text on your phone saying, "Why didn't you go home last night?" Meaning that Bob had followed your friend home to their house to see that they had not gone home. Why would he follow them home? Maybe because he got freaked out about all the weird stuff he confessed to when he got... Then your friend and Dave sit on it for 3 days before deciding to go to the police. They tell the police about a quarter of the story and then they're stopped and said, "Wait, I need to get a higher up cop." They tell the police about a quarter of the story again and he says, "Wait, I need to get a higher up cop." They finally get all the way through the story and everyone's like, "We know Bob. This is a small town. That doesn't sound like Bob. This is Bob." And they're like, "I know it's Bob. He's basically my grandfather. I'm telling you, it was weird. I've known him my whole life." Then they say, "Okay, we're gonna put a wire on your friend's friend Dave and send you to Bob's house and see what he says." Then your friend's friend Dave goes to Bob's house and tries to be all casual and get him to confess to it again, but of course Bob is smart and knows that you're acting weird because he's known you your entire life and says, "I was just kidding, I can't believe you fell for that." Then when the police hear that, they go, "See, you're nuts, it's just good old Bob." But a week later, they decide to raid him anyways, where they do find the weapon and they do find the skulls, and they take them away from him like, "Bob, you know you're not supposed to have that." And then your friend just has to go back to the Appalachian Trail thinking that she's met a serial killer, almost got killed, and then told the police and wasn't believed because he's a prominent member of society.
That's actually, like, so frightening, in an obviously, like, not even paranormal way. It's so frightening, the fact that they're just not even looking into this guy because, like, they know him. So, like, how could he possibly do that? But that's the thing, is it's always like, "Oh, well, you know, we knew this person. We can't believe that they'd do that." It's always like that. But you know how many times you hear on the news, "Oh, well, you know, that was just Sally. I can't believe she'd do something like that. I knew her so well. That's so out of character." This is concerning on many levels, not even just a paranormal aspect. Like, it is mind-blowing to me, but also not surprising at the same time that they would just brush something off like this. I mean, how many times do you hear of, like, people are warned in advance about a person and something terrible happens anyway because no one took it seriously? I think it is insane that Bob might be a serial killer and he's just right under everyone's noses and they're just not even paying attention because it's just Bob. But Bob could be a serial killer. Like, this is literal evidence that you cannot trust anyone. I really hope that they actually look into this and do something about it before, you know, potentially someone else gets harmed, or Dave. At least this girl, if she can go home and leave the Appalachian Trail. But, I mean, Dave, like, if he really made this guy angry, like, who knows what could happen to him. So, pretty crazy story. Our next TikTok is by the user Diesel Hill. And I don't even know how to explain this. It's like someone hacked their microwave and is trying to speak to them through it.
Oh, hear this.
Talk dirty to me. Talk dirty to me. I'm a man.
What the heck is happening? Like, that is so scary. It's like, I don't know, for some reason it, like, reminds me of a spirit box. It's like they're tapping into a spirit box and hearing something. Obviously it's not, it's like a human, but it's like, it's giving that. And it just makes me really uncomfortable, the thought of, like, somehow there's some radio communication with a person. Like, are they able to listen to you? Or, like, where is this coming from exactly? I guess microwaves would have a speaker for the beep, but, like, how is there a talking voice coming out of the microwave? Like, I'm just, like, not understanding what's happening. When I read the caption before it actually happened, I was, like, confused. And then when I heard the person, my heart, like, skipped a beat. Like, that is so terrifying. And I would love to have an explanation for this. The next TikTok is by the user Definitely Not Haley G. And she tells us a story about a teacher she was really, really close with in eighth grade. She has a kind of friendship with her history teacher and is always helping her around the classroom and talking with her. And this teacher told her, you know, you're my favorite student. But this is her second year teaching. So Haley asks, do you have any other favorite students? And she says, yes, I had a favorite student at the previous school that I taught at last year. At the end of the year, the teacher writes Haley a note, and you know, Haley moves on with her life. She ends up dating this guy, and they're talking about their teachers, and she brings up this teacher that she just loved and says that she kind of had a crush on her and asked her boyfriend, Chaz, if he ever had a crush on a teacher too, to which he says yes, and they find out that he also had a crush on the same teacher when she taught at his school the year prior. They find out that he was the favorite student, and when she rereads a letter from her teacher, the teacher says, P.S. You should look up the other student named Chaz. I think you guys would really get along.
You guys want to talk invisible string? I have the craziest story. Truly, this is the craziest story. Buckle up. So let's go back in time. I'm in eighth grade. I have this history teacher. I am in love with her. It's a big moment in my life for a lot of reasons. And then she also like introduces me to Stevie Nicks. Like I'm spending the hour after school before practice in her room, and she's like teaching me about cool music and cool art and like cool movies. Like she's just really, really, really cool. And I was in love with her. And we were very close, not in a weird way, just in like the good student teacher way. And it's very obvious that I'm her favorite student, and it was her second year teaching. So I asked her once, I was like, oh, do you have another favorite student? And she was like, I have one from each year. Like I have my favorite student from last year, but it's a tie. Like you guys are always gonna be my favorites, my top two forever. And I thought that was very, very sweet, and I loved her. So now it's the last day of the school year. I'm bawling because like she's leaving, and I'm very upset about it because she really shaped my life in a big way. And she writes me this letter, and it's very, very sweet, and I keep it forever. I keep it at my parents' house. So 6, 7, whatever it is, years later, I'm dating Chaz, and we're talking about crushes on teachers. And I was like, oh my God, I had a huge crush on my history teacher in eighth grade. Like, she changed my life. Huge crush on her, loved her. And he said, oh, I had a huge crush on my history teacher also in eighth grade, and same teacher. She had taught at his school the year before. And I said, oh, she wrote me a letter. Let me go, like, try to find it. I go find the letter. This is so crazy. I'm like shaking. At the bottom of the letter, it says, when you're older, look up my other favorite student, Chaz Godier. That's his name. Look up Chaz Godier. You two would make a perfect pairing, if not great friends. Like, and we were just standing there looking at the letter like when he was a 13-year-old boy. And when she knew me, I was a 13-year-old girl. And we're standing there as 20 and 22 being like, this person, this woman called, like, is that not insane? We invited her to our wedding. She sent us a nice gift. Like, she's very, very sweet. But is that not, like, look at my hand. Like, is that not crazy?
That is so insane to me. Like, for sure, invisible string theory. I am honestly obsessed with this. I am just so amazed with how everything is so perfectly connected to everything else. The fact like that she obviously knew both of them well enough to know that they would get along so well is crazy to me. And the fact that they found each other on their own is even crazier. This isn't like as frightening, but it's just like so unbelievable. The next story is by the user horror_chronicles. She tells us all about her experience living in Rhode Island around the time that the Conjuring movies came out. If you don't know, the Conjuring house is in Rhode Island. She lived there around the time that the first Conjuring movie came out. And after going to see this movie multiple times, takes a trip to Bathsheba Sherman's gravesite.
Put a finger down if when The Conjuring came out, you were 18 years old and you also are born and raised in Rhode Island where this movie takes place, or like literally 20 minutes from where this movie takes place, because everything in Rhode Island is 20 minutes from each other and nothing cool ever happens in Rhode Island. So this took the state by fucking storm. It was absolute pandemonium, chaos. You go see this movie opening night with a group of your friends and you quite literally shit your fucking pants and can't sleep for days. You are horrified. And at this point, even at 18, you're a seasoned horror lover and nothing's ever affected you as badly as this has. So what do? You continue to chase that high and you go back to the theater 3 more times to see it, for a total of 4 times seeing it. And by the 4th time, you're not scared anymore, right? And you go with your friend Kyle, who's this big football player, and he's so scared because it's his first time seeing it. And he is squeezing your hand so hard the whole time, that you actually lose circulation in your hand. You literally cannot feel your hand by the end of this movie. And then you get in his car thinking that he's taking you home, but he starts going a little bit more north than where you live. And you're like, that's weird. I think we're going somewhere that I don't really want to fucking go right now, aka Harrisville, Rhode Island, aka the Conjuring House. And I say, where are we going? And he says, don't worry about it. And you're panicking because you don't want to fucking go because you're still horrified by this movie, even though you've seen it four times and it's not as scary. Like, it's still fucking scary. So you like want to cry and shit your pants, but you don't because you're like, you're a fucking G, like don't let him see you cry. So you sit there and you're like, fuck it, let's do it. So you get there and you pass the house and you can't actually like go onto the property because at this point it belonged to like a family and it was private property and there were cops everywhere and people were getting arrested all the time. It was a whole thing. But where you can go is the public cemetery where Bathsheba Sherman, the real Bathsheba Sherman, is buried. So you pull into this little tiny graveyard that is across from a fire station. And as you're pulling into this graveyard, I shit you not, the skies open up. It's a sunny summer day in July. The skies open up, it starts raining. So now you're fucking shitting your pants even more. And you find this grave, you approach it, and you get out and you take a quick picture with it. And then you guys speed away because you're both absolutely fucking terrified and nobody knows why you did this. And then you proceed to get home. Again, you're 18, you live with your mom and your sister at the time. And you show them this picture that you took with the grave. And your sister starts screaming, saying that you're going to be possessed and you're bringing something into this house and something's going to latch itself to you. And she doesn't want to stay here anymore with you because you've ruined the family and you're going to get everybody killed. And you're terrified. So you start crying and it's absolute chaos and your mom's yelling. And that's the story of how I believed for two whole weeks that I was going to be possessed by the witch from The Conjuring. And that's also the scariest time of my life. And I didn't sleep for weeks. Bathsheba. Her grave actually very sadly was defaced not long after this, but I made it before then.
Okay, I will say, I don't know why, but for some reason, the original Conjuring is like my comfort ghost movie. Like, I don't know what it is. I've seen it so many times. It's not really scary. There's a few parts that like I do close my eyes for. So maybe I'm lying when I say it's not that scary. But like I, for some reason, I just really like that movie. Like, it's scary, don't get me wrong. But it's just like, it's a really good movie. The bravery of this girl to not only, you know, go past the Conjuring House, but also go to Bathsheba Sherman's grave. I don't think I would be brave enough to do that. I absolutely would have told him to turn the car around and go home. So props to her for sticking it out and getting close enough to like take a picture next to it. The next few TikToks I am going to show you are part of a series by the user YayaTiz. So this girl is in the middle of a cross-country move that she is currently doing by herself. She is staying in a short-term Airbnb rental in the meantime until she finds a permanent apartment to live in, but she is having some weird experiences. On the property, it's like a multi-unit building, but in her little section, there is only access to her door, and then there is a supposed storage closet right next to her unit. But one day, she hears vacuuming coming from this storage closet. And she keeps hearing people going in and out of it. She thinks it's really weird because, I mean, how long could you possibly be vacuuming in a small storage closet? She thinks that it must be some kind of a secret unit or something like that. She realizes that she could take a peek behind this door because she has a window that for some reason looks into this room. So she takes a peek behind the blinds through this window and sees a staircase going down somewhere. Like, this is supposed to be a storage closet, and it's just a staircase. So she ends up asking the Airbnb host, like, what's going on? Like, because it's weird. And they end up accidentally admitting, they misunderstand her, and they end up accidentally admitting to there being a secret entrance to her apartment behind the stove, which is not what she was asking about, before they then say that supposedly a family member is living in the storage closet basement. They give her permission to investigate, and when she does, it gets really weird.
Guys, I know you're not gonna believe me when I tell you this, but something weird is happening with my short-term lease, and I swear to God, this is not clickbait. I just need proof that it exists somewhere. Can you tell me if I'm freaking out or not? I'm trying to whisper because I'm pretty sure that the host that owns my unit also lives in this building, okay? So the building itself, I'm pretty confident, is split into four living spaces, which is fine. I'm in unit D, so I imagine there's at least four, and I really liked my unit. No issues at all, okay? I mean, aside from finding the siren under my bed, but you guys were there for that, and we decided it was no big deal, right? Okay, but listen. So my unit, my short-term lease, is literally just this room, and then there's like a little kitchen and a little bathroom. Like, nothing can happen to me here because there's no one here, but then, okay, something I thought was a little bit weird, but I let it go because I knew I was just being paranoid, is that when you come to the entrance of my
most of my unit on the outside. There's like a keypad. You can see it in my last couple of videos. But there's like another door right here that leads to a door marked storage closet. Okay, are you following me? Now, this is a window that leads to that storage closet, but the window is screwed shut. And there's like opaque covered, like it looks like this. So you can't see through the window. So I know that no one can get into the window. And I was like, I guess I'm not worried about it. Oh my God, they're literally sitting outside my door. I can hear them. Okay, so earlier tonight, I was sitting on my couch, and I heard someone vacuuming in the storage closet, and I was like, it's a really small room, I don't know how someone could be vacuuming. So I was like, that's weird. Well, I step outside, when this person goes away, I'll film for you, but I stepped outside my door, and I held my ear next to the storage closet door, and I could hear the vacuum on that side, like maybe it's an entrance to another unit, and I was like, that's weird, why would it be called storage unit? They're literally still by the door. Oh my God, the owner's calling me. Hold on a second. Okay, I just got off the phone with the owner and he explained something weird to me, but I gotta back up because I don't think it makes any sense. Okay, so earlier tonight I heard a vacuum cleaner and I realized when I step outside and put my ear to that door that it's not really a closet, it's like another entrance. And I was like, oh, that's weird. So I went to the window and I lifted that like weird window covering, and when I looked down, it's a staircase. It's not a room, it's literally a staircase down. Even on the door outside said storage closet. And I was like, okay, that's fucking weird. But still, I'm like, hey, you're still really paranoid from what happened before and you have anxiety, so definitely double check it. So I messaged the host and I was like, hey, weird, hold on, I'll show you this. My host is an angel. Like, look how sweet this message was when I first got here. But look, hi Vanessa, I heard vacuuming coming from the storage closet next to the unit. I get the impression it's not a closet, but rather an entrance, blah, 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 blah. I asked if I should be concerned. Wait till you see what you fucking messaged me. She said, hey Janine, rest assured, the door that is behind the stove can only be opened from your side. What door behind the stove? So before she sent me the rest of this, I went to look at the stove because the stove wasn't even on my fucking radar. Here's my kitchen, here's my stove, okay? And apparently there's a door behind that stove.
Sorry, what?
You're gonna have to tell me if that's weird or not, because I'm literally like, oh, this. side. Because there's a mysterious staircase behind a door labeled storage closet that the brother doesn't live in but is making a bed downstairs that he keeps supplies in, but he can't come through that door even though I heard him come through that door. You heard it. You heard the audio. Like, listen. If I get murdered, check the storage closet stairs and also apparently check the door behind the stove. Like, what is going on? This is my luck, guys.
I honestly, at this point, would feel already so unsafe. Like, it's really weird that the storage closet is, like, a lie. But then for them to tell you about a secret door behind your stove that you didn't know about, which means that someone could potentially have access to your living space, and then for them to say that a family member is living in the storage closet is weird. I really do not blame her for not going down there. Like, everything in me as she's, like, talking about how they're saying that she can go down there was screaming not to, because I'm just thinking, like, it is a trap for sure. So I am glad that she did not go down there and investigate in this video. She posts a part two, giving a little bit more context about how the whole unit in itself looks, and I think this is really helpful to picture everything. The first part was a little bit confusing trying to envision what she was talking about, but now with the added video of what the unit actually looks like, it makes a lot more sense and I think somehow makes it creepier. She seems to be more calm in the part two that I'm about to show you, but I somehow think it makes it worse.
Update on the situation with my short-term lease. Yes, I'm still alive. I had a good night's sleep. I'm on my anxiety meds, and so I have a lot more in context, but I'm curious what you think about everything that's, like, connected together this morning. I had lots of recommendations for security measures. This one's my favorite. I have two of these door stoppers, so if someone tried to open the door, they couldn't get in, and there's a huge alarm if they did anyway. So I wasn't really nervous that someone was gonna come in, but I was nervous why they'd kept that a secret and why that person was standing on the other side of the door. For context, this is the outside of my unit. Those two windows go to that storage closet, but this door goes to a hallway. So if you're exiting from my unit, here's my door. You open it up, there's the hallway, and then the door I just showed you across the way. But to the right is that storage closet door that's marked storage closet. Now, it actually doesn't worry me that this space is here or that it's maybe used for something else. Like, it's fine if it is the basement. I just thought it was weird that it was named that. And there's also a camera always in this section. So there's a camera on the ceiling and this rug moves every so often. So I assumed people were going in and out of it with me, which made me a little uneasy. So this is the windows that go to that storage closet from inside of my room. So as you can see, they have that opaque film covering and it just lets natural light in, okay? No big deal. Now, when I heard someone on the other side of this window, mind you, it's dark when this happened, I lifted up this window covering and the light was on in this area. And once you'll see here, it's stairs. So you'll see the other side of the door and then it's just a staircase down. So there's no storage in here at all. Now, listen, I'm definitely aware that this could be totally normal. I get the impression, if you were to ask me right now, that that's just like another dwelling unit that they don't want people to know about because it's like not up to code or something like that. So for like inspections, they have the storage closet label on there. I'm not super worried about that. What I was worried about is when I was on the phone with the owner, he specifically said the only people who have access to that area are him and his wife and they're not on property. And that's when I was like, no, 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 I hear someone down there right now. He was just standing outside my door. And he was like, oh, well, that's actually my sister's brother. So he sometimes has access to that area. And I was like, ooh. So he literally like had me go down there. But they could have looked at the camera in that entryway and seen that the brother was there. So I was just confused at why they were not telling me the whole truth and then making stuff up as I went along. And then it just like wasn't super clear what they were telling me. Now, in fairness, English is their second language, which is not a problem. They communicated everything fine, but there were a couple of things where I was like, I can't tell if this is a language barrier or if this is like you being sneaky. Because like when he said that no one was down there, no one had access but him and his wife, but then actually his brother was down there, like that made me feel really uncomfortable. So I think I would have just put this behind me and not really looked into it, except that when I texted her just so I could feel a little less anxious about it, just because I'm a little on edge. Then she was like, let me explain the stove door. So I didn't even know there was a door behind the stove, which is what really gave me a red flag. I was like, why are they not disclosing some of these components to me? And remember, this is on top of them not disclosing the siren under the bed. So I had already felt really like, what is going on? Like, am I being stupid? That's why I posted about it. I was like, can someone tell me if I'm being anxious or if I'm just losing it? I would rather err on the side of caution and not be on the next episode of a true crime podcast, but trust me when I say that I'm doing my best to secure permanent housing. I have felt safe in this unit so far. I think the thing I'm concerned about now, like if you ask me right now what I'm worried, it's just that I'm a little worried that someone's coming into my unit when I'm not there, or that because I didn't know that there's like people under me or to the side of me that they're like watching in some way. So when I get home tonight, I'm gonna do another check for cameras and just like get a better sense of the surroundings outside of my room, because I felt safe up until this point. But it's like, please just don't be going in my room or being weird in some other way, or like, I just
I've gone through a lot trying to figure out housing, and I just really could use something normal. Like, I just don't want anything unexplained anymore. Like, predictable is what I'm going for right now. Anyway, I've got 4 houses that I'm looking at with a realtor on Thursday. I'm hopeful that one of those goes through because I am definitely over it. So hopefully I'm not in here for very much longer, but you know that if I go missing, check. This is literally the second time in the last few weeks that there was a secret set of stairs that someone else had access to and didn't tell me about. What is going on? This is some weird karmic shit or something. Anyway, I'm not dead, but close to it. Just tell me if I should be taking this more seriously. Right now, I'm just kind of letting it go. Anyway, okay, bye.
Using the code that she was given the night before, she goes into the basement to check it out. And it is not a basement. It may be underground, but it's not a basement. It is like a communal living area. It's like room after room after room. There's like a communal bathroom and a little kitchenette. And then like a weird staircase upstairs with more rooms. It's like honestly kind of giving like dorm room vibes in a way. There's no one there. There is one room that is clear someone is sleeping in. But other than that, there is nobody there. And again, she says that exploring this makes her feel better, but it really just makes me feel worse about the whole situation.
Guys, I snuck into the basement. When I was on the phone with the owner, I didn't go into the basement, I just looked down the stairs. What's down there is weird, but definitely less terrifying. Obviously, I'm alive, but I'm gonna make you experience it the same way I did. When the owner was on the phone, he said that he would turn off the camera if I was interested, so I looked when I entered today to see if he had turned off the camera, and alas, he did not. And that's when I decided I'm going through the window. So we started our investigation by unscrewing the window. I was trying to be really quiet because I knew if someone was living down there, they would hear me open the window. I hadn't heard any noise down here, so I figured either they weren't there or the murderer was not ready to murder me. Wouldn't murder a guest in the daylight either, but that's why I was so nervous the other day when the noise was so late at night. So here's a better look of the quote-unquote storage closet. So I removed the screen and then jumped in. I realized once I got here though that I didn't know what was at the bottom of the stairs since I'd only seen it in the dark, so I did some investigative work. We put my phone under the board to see what's at the bottom. I realized that there's a motion-sensitive camera down in the corner, and I thought, damn, it's on. I can't do anything about that camera down there, but I can disengage the camera at the front of the door. Maybe it's less monitored. The owner said he was going to do it anyway, so I'm sure he won't mind. Luckily, that camera's plug was within arm's reach, so I was able to unplug. I don't know why I'm whispering now. I guess I'm just thinking about how scared I was in that moment. Because then I had to decide, like, okay, am I really going down into the basement alone? This is how every white girl dies in every movie. The camera was off, and I just thought, I'll feel so much better when I know what's down there, whatever it is. So we took a deep breath, remembered the code he told me the other night, and I went into the basement. I almost peed my pants right here because the lock automatically relocks, and it scared the shit out of me. All right, here we go. Flash on.
Hello, is anyone down here?
Hello? Just a quick check for murderers, but I also felt if it's not a murderer, I want to make sure that they know I'm coming. Like, I don't want to be the creep going into someone's space. That's exactly what I was afraid of. In hindsight, that feels kind of stupid. I don't know why I was still trying to be polite. Anyway, no response, and it turns out it is a door with a curtain on it. So I looked at the curtain, but I couldn't see through the window. But then I thought, if the door is unlocked, then it's just a storage area. But there was a lock on the handle, but only from my side. Weird. So I went in. It's a long hallway of locked rooms. I couldn't tell if it was like an undisclosed Airbnb space or if these doors were just random because they didn't tell me anyone lived below me. They said this was just a cleaning supply area. So it's definitely not just an empty basement, and it's definitely not a storage area. It's a nice little area where things are split into different dwellings. And by the way, this space goes on forever. So there's like 5 rooms down here. There's a little kitchen area. That other door is locked, so I don't know where that goes. But then there was a door here, which couldn't be the door behind my stove because I'm below my unit right now, but I realized it was bolted shut. That did make me feel better in the moment, but in hindsight, I'm like, why is that door shut? Anyway, secret set of stairs number 2. This brings the grand total of secret staircases since I moved to Philadelphia up to 3. Brings me to another level of, you guessed it, more dwellings. You gotta give the owners credit. They have seriously maximized this space. And I can understand now why they didn't disclose it, because it's definitely not up to code. I felt like I was already pushing my luck, so I wasn't gonna go up the last staircase. I came back down the stairs, and then I just said hello to make sure no one was in there who needed help behind any of these doors. And only one of them was unlocked, which ended up being someone's sleeping space. Obviously, we shut the door. I don't know why someone would keep their space unlocked. Apparently, I'm the only paranoid person in this building. We have caught the owner in a couple lies, including that this space is locked, so they can't even get through the staircase to my unit. They definitely can. I get why they didn't tell me. I definitely wouldn't have said yes to the short-term lease if I knew that there were like 40 other people living in the building with me. At least there was no obvious signs of some basement filled with cameras looking at everything in my room. So we're gonna lock up the window, lock our door, and definitely reframe this whole experience as I'm living in a hotel. I guess more like a hostel. I still have no idea where the door behind the stove goes to, but I imagine it's just another labyrinth of additional furnished finder spaces. I'm assuming that makes us all feel a little bit more safe. Kinda. Yeah. Better than before, I think. I'll keep you posted though. You never know.
Now, the next 3 TikToks I am going to show you consist of her investigating behind the stove, realizing that they lied about the door not being able to open from the other side, getting cameras, and then realizing that she does in fact need to move out.
It's happening. We're figuring out the door behind the stove. I started by quietly sitting in this room because I hear the most foot traffic behind the wall. And when I was peeling off this plastic, that's when I heard them. I actually think what happened is they heard me because I heard a loud noise behind the wall. And it sounded like someone was running down a hallway, running down the stairs, running up the stairs. And then I could hear someone outside of my window and then the keypad clicking. Not my door, the door to the basement. Would be coincidental timing. I don't know. Couldn't pull the stove toward me because it's plugged in from the back. So I tried to see if we could see what was behind it from the side. Nothing on the left. So I went over to the right side of the cabinet in this tiny room. There is this little space between the cabinet and the wall, but I couldn't see anything. I started looking more closely at the actual wall behind the stove, and it turns out it's actually just one big plywood board. It's covered pretty well with this fake tile and marble. It's a pretty thin piece of wood, but it looks like it's not covering the whole wall, which is what's making me thinking that this whole covering is the door behind the stove. I couldn't lift or move any of that paneling, so I just thought I better just get my camera behind the stove and see what's there. That's when I noticed this spot behind the stove that's just covered in duct tape from the other side, and I thought, bingo. I slid my phone over the top and found the friggin' door. Contrary to what the owner said, the door opens from the other side. I couldn't have opened it from my side anyway. Here's another view from the left side of the stove. Just a regular handle on that door. There's no lock. So it seems that when they open that door, they move the panel that's on the top of the stove, and that's how they get in. Clearly, this room used to connect to that part of the house. I mean, it technically still does. You just open the door and push the stove away from you. It's obviously concerning that they could get to me, but I can't get out of the room from there. I kept hearing this sound. Which sort of sounds like a soap dispenser. So I guess it could be a bathroom, maybe a kitchen. Doesn't sound all that suspicious, so I guess we'll let it go for now. I do think the whole building is just split up in some really weird ways. Still concerned that there's an entrance to my unit that's gone undisclosed. At any time, it would be really easy to go through that wall, a door that's unlocked, move the stove, and immediately have entrance into my unit. And if it's just a shared kitchen or a bathroom, I really don't like that all of the guests in the house would have access to here. There's really nothing left to do except for put another alarm system on this door. Luckily, we have another door stopper. I've gone through 6 viewings, and I have 3 applications out for housing, so just keep your fingers crossed. No more secret stairs or doors, please. Thanks. Don't worry, guys. Camera's secured. No one's coming in on my watch. I know y'all have been telling me to get a camera forever, but I'm telling you, I'm in the middle of the city with no car, not a real address to send anything to, and so it takes a long while to figure out how to get something to me. Don't worry, Wyze has pulled through. Introducing the Wyze SmartCam V3, baby. Not one, but 2. I had to get the same number of cameras as secret entrances that I know about to my unit. Is it overkill? Maybe. But to all the men who say I'm overreacting in my comments, you should know. I would not purchase this many cameras if I was alone in the woods with the bear. No one's murdered me yet, so we're in for the final stretch. I'd get out of this shortly sooner if I can, but I can't, so I'm gonna save the money that I would get out of that shortly and use it to get into my new place. You heard me right. Drumroll, please. New place, June 1. We manifested it, guys. Now I just have to live to the end of the month. I cannot believe I just signed our lease and sent the deposit. Take a screenshot for the scrapbook. Now when I'm at work, I'll be able to tell if someone's trying to sneak in my apartment or karate chop their way in. Tomorrow will be the first day that I have my camera going during the workday, so we'll see how it goes. I'm just going to assume I'm safe because I don't have any more space, any more capacity to think about being unsafe anymore. Oh, there's a green suitcase cameo. I'm choosing to live in the same world that 5% of my commenters live in. And just trust that this is mostly anxiety. Like maybe if I just do my full skincare routine and my gua sha, nothing will happen to me. Or I guess I'll just have nice skin if it does. Jokes aside, I'm really tired. Since finding out we got the house, I just feel like my whole body is ready to just fall. But I'm doing the best I can with what I've got. Tomorrow morning, I'm gonna pull the floor plans for this building and see if I can find anything good. And the real front entrance has to be here somewhere, right? I guess we'll see. Okay, love you. See you. Guys, I gave up. I left that place. I never got to the bottom of what's behind the door, behind the stove, or behind the third staircase after the back room's basement. Honestly, I've just been in such a heightened state of anxiety for the entire 9 weeks I've been in Philadelphia. I found myself not caring anymore if someone came through the window, or the secret door behind the stove, or the basement. Honestly, I had just been dysregulated for so long, and the fighting of the couple above me had kept me awake for days that I really think I lost my mind. I'm really vulnerable to that, which is why I never would have stayed in this space if I knew it was going to be this activating. So I upped my anxiety meds, I packed my green suitcases, and I booked that hotel room. Also, there was just so many comments of people saying that I was overreacting or I was paranoid or I was acting manic, and I just thought, if that's true and I'm perfectly safe here, then clearly there's something wrong with my brain. I just sat myself down and said, if my 7-year-old self came to me and was this dysregulated, what would I do? And honestly, I would just take her out of the friggin' room. I would tell her it's perfectly reasonable to be that upset. I would tell her that I trust her and that now it's time to take care of her and make sure her body feels safe. Because at the end of the day, I'm just a person living my life behind a viral video, and that person just needed to feel normal again. So right now I'm reporting from a very boring hotel room with nothing out of the ordinary, but I don't want to jinx it this time. Just know that I'm quietly holding on to the next 10 days because that's when we get into the new place. It will be the 8th and final place I unpack these green suitcases. I am really grateful that the Wyze cameras were easy to reinstall somewhere new. They keep an eye on me almost as frequently as my ex-girlfriend's sorority sisters. We broke up 6 years ago. Find something new to talk about in your group chats. I'll see you guys in my new space. Bye.
Now, this whole series was a whirlwind for me. I was fascinated when I stumbled upon this. I really do think leaving was the correct decision. While the owners did seem nice and mostly transparent about everything when she asked, I do think it's concerning that there are so many undisclosed living spaces behind a locked door that, I mean, it is already risky. Obviously, you live in a super populated area. There's more people that could potentially be doing harm. I just personally think it's incredibly unsafe that there could be so many people that are not supposed to be living there that are living there. And I mean, who knows what could happen? Like, to me, the whole thing just felt really off and creepy. Just personally, the whole thing felt really off to me. So I'm glad that she did get out of there safely. And I am also very glad that she documented the whole thing for TikTok. Our next TikTok is by the user Jay McKnowledge. And this one is kind of on the humorous side of spooky things. But this man works in a funeral home. And he decides to test out a filter that says what you are, how old you are, and what emotion you are feeling. While he's in the funeral home testing this filter out, as I'm sure you can already guess, an unknown object appears in the background, appearing to be hundreds of years old and angry. Now, at first I thought this was real, but I am fairly certain that this filter is a joke and does this for everyone. I personally don't want to test it out just in case, but I think it is humorous how it shows up as unknown, 500 plus years old, and angry. And I love how the person's face just switches from like fear to shock. The next TikTok is by the user IsabelleRiley19, and she shares a story that is from one of her coworkers about when he was visiting New Orleans. He was dining at one of the oldest restaurants in New Orleans, and when given a tour of the wine cellar, he snapped a couple pictures, only to find out that he was able to capture a crystal clear full body apparition.
I need to tell you guys about the most insane evidence that I have ever seen of a ghost existing. Photos will be included. Backstory. I was at a company get-together with my CEOs, my coworkers, and one of the owners of the company. We all looked at us and was like, hey, do you guys want to see a ghost picture? Immediately, yes. He begins to tell us that he was in New Orleans at a restaurant called Antoine's. New Orleans, first of all, super haunted city. If you know, you know. And Antoine's is one of the oldest restaurants in the city. One of the oldest restaurants, I believe, in America. It has a lot of history. It used to be a jail. It is a really well-established place, has been around forever. So he's dining at this restaurant and he's offered a tour of the wine cellar. The wine cellar is huge, has thousands of bottles of wine, probably worth millions of dollars. So he's taking a tour of the wine cellar, he's taking pictures. There's this guy in the wine cellar on a laptop who is apparently at auction buying more rare wine for the collection. My CEO takes pictures of this guy on his laptop, doesn't think anything of it, he doesn't see anything, leaves the restaurant, calls it a day. The next morning, he's looking through the photos and notices something in one of the pictures that he took in the wine cellar. I'm going to upload the first picture that he took. There's nothing that immediately jumped out in this picture, but I want to give a baseline. So this is the first picture that he showed me from the wine cellar. You can see this guy who is on his laptop at auction, doing whatever. And here is the next picture that he took. So we all see that. That is a full body apparition. It looks like a woman in this like black Victorian dress. And when I was showed this, I genuinely had full body chills. That is insane. So he showed that to me. And keep in mind, he is showing me pictures from his camera roll. Like, in sequence, time-stamped. Those two pictures were like a minute apart. If that, like probably seconds apart. I see all the other pictures from his trip. This is not edited. He's also not the kind of person who would do anything like that. Like, he hasn't posted this anywhere. It's just a story that he was telling us. I've never seen anything like this, and I need to not be alone in seeing this, because holy shit.
When I saw his TikTok, I was like about to go to bed, and I'm not kidding, this freaked me out. I had a hard time falling asleep after that, because the way she is just so crystal clear is insane to me. Like, she's there. You can see her. It's not some like little smudgy thing like you can't make out. That is a woman in a like poofy Victorian gown. Clear as day. You cannot question that. That is exactly what it looks like. And it makes me so uncomfortable. I feel like she might be nice or just neutral, but You know, it is really so creepy. I love seeing these photos that when people have this experience where they take a couple photos and like they're all the same except for one. To me, that's proof right there. Because if it just shows up in one, it shows that it wasn't just like some trick of the light or something. Wow. Like I was frightened when I saw this. It is so crazy how clear this evidence is. Our next TikTok is by the user jfoy_3.0. And he believes his grandpa is the Zodiac killer. Now, I have three TikToks here that he's posted that I am going to share with you all three right in a row. The fact that this guy claims his grandfather is the Zodiac killer is crazy. And there is really so much evidence to prove it's true. And honestly, I believe it. I'll give you a chance to soak this in and make a decision for yourself.
Hey guys, so quick update from editing Abby. Since I filmed this video a few weeks ago, he has posted so many updates. There are just way too many to include in this video. I just told you I was gonna show you parts 1 through 3 because that's what was out when I filmed this. Again, there's like so many parts now. It's probably like 10 to 15. I'm gonna show you parts 1 through 4. And then if you guys are interested in hearing the rest of them, you can head over to his profile to take a look at those. If you guys are super, super interested, I would love to do a dedicated deep dive on this story in particular. So let me know if you want me to do that. But for the purposes of this video, it's just way too long to include all of them. So enjoy parts 1 through 4. And I hope you are as mind blown as I was when I first saw these.
My grandpa is the motherfucking Zodiac killer, and this is not clickbait, so please, I need the power of the internet to share this, bookmark it, and blow my comment section up. I want to start off by saying this is not just based off physical appearance. I typed in my grandpa's name on Google the other day, and to my fucking surprise, internet sleuths have been throwing my grandpa's name around for years, connecting him as the Zodiac motherfucking killer. As you can see here in all these pictures on the screen somewhere, that it looks exactly like my grandpa. Let's talk about it. My grandpa was a Vallejo police officer. Yes, the same area where the Zodiac killer's fucking killings took place. Let's move forward. Let's talk about the Darlene Sharon murder. Let me tell you, this is not in any order, but the more evidence I give you, you are going to be convinced that my grandpa is in fact the Zodiac killer. Darlene Farron and her boyfriend Mike or Matt, forgot the fucking guy's name, were driving around Vallejo one night, the night that my grandfather happened to be on duty driving an unmarked police car and wearing plain clothes. Mike, who ended up surviving the shooting, said that they were being followed around by this car all night in Vallejo before they pulled into Blue Rock Springs. They said when they parked, the car pulled in, a man hopped out of the car, and Darlene, the girl who passed away, said, "Oh my God, that's Richard. He's gonna kill us both." Apparently, she was dating a police officer in Vallejo behind her husband's back. She was apparently a thotty. Rest in peace, Darlene Farron. So this guy in her passenger seat is one of her many boyfriends. And it was well known by her friend group that she was dating a Vallejo cop, although she never told them the name. She had a painting party at her house a few weeks before her murder. And it was said that my grandfather, Richard Hoffman, showed up uninvited. And she told her circle of friends that she is scared to death of him. And he was not invited there. My grandpa denies these claims. He says he never laid eyes on her, but then later goes on to say, "I know that she worked at a restaurant locally here in Vallejo." How the fuck have you never laid eyes on her, Grandpa? You tell me about that. Let's move forward. As Mike said, right before they got shot, she said, "That's Richard. He's going to kill us both." My grandpa's name is fucking Richard Hoffman. Now let's talk about something else that I thought was really weird. In a letter that the Zodiac wrote, and my grandpa's police reports, and also this poem that I'm going to talk about later, my grandpa spells the word "until" wrong. He spells it wrong. He puts two L's at the end. Where in multiple letters that the Zodiac wrote, he also spells "until" with two L's at the motherfucking end. Well, let's talk about the Sherry Bates murder that took place a couple years before the Darlene Farron murder. She was in a library doing her homework. She had just moved from Nebraska. Nebraska, why do I mention that? Because my grandpa lived in Nebraska. My mother, biological mother, was born in Nebraska. My grandpa was also in the Navy. Sherry Bates' brother was also in the Navy. This is weird, right? It's all coming together. Well, this murder took place. She was at the library studying. One night, she leaves and gets shot up, where they found a poem handwritten underneath a motherfucking desk. And forensic analysis and handwriting analysis say that it's the exact writings of the Zodiac. And they say that this is possible. Possibly the first killing that the Zodiac ever did. Well, this letter was initialed RH at the very bottom. RH, Richard Hoffman. Forensic analysis experts said that that letter was written by the Zodiac. So why is no one connecting this to my motherfucking grandpa? Somebody tell me why. It is said that my grandpa and Darlene, the one who got shot in Blue Rock Springs, had a romantic sexual relationship behind everybody's back, behind my grandma's back. Let's talk about his character. My grandpa's character, he was known in my family to be abusive, controlling, manipulating, and also unfaithful to my grandmother. Now we're going to sit here and pretend that my grandpa didn't do this shit. They also say that the crime scene was tampered with. Why did Darlene's family get a call that she was shot before the cops even knew about it? And that call was placed by a payphone outside of Vallejo Police Department. Someone tell me that. And my grandpa was first on scene to that shooting. And later it was revealed that that scene was tampered with. My grandpa showed up on scene within 5 minutes of the shooting being reported. He sent away the officers that responded with him. Who sends away responding officers on a possible double murder? And the crime scene was tampered with. It was later revealed. So you're still going to tell me my grandpa is not the Zodiac killer. What are we going to do about it? I don't fucking know. My grandpa's on vacation in a grave somewhere. But I'm convinced my grandpa was a Zodiac killer. Yesterday, I posted a video that's now at like 3 million views talking about how my grandpa, Richard Hoffman, was a Zodiac killer. There's a lot of questions in the comments section. I'm going to try to address those. I'm also going to show you guys a few clips from a documentary that includes my grandpa interviewing, acting weird. To my knowledge, it's acting weird for him.
During the ride to the hospital. And of course, her shirt or sweater, whatever she was wearing, was off. And each time that ambulance attendant blew air into her chest, there was a little piece of material from her bra that I could see fluttered with every breath he blew into that girl. This piece of material would flip.
And then a witness statement from the guy Mike, who was with Darlene Farron the night of the shooting in Blue Rock Springs.
A friend of hers, not to worry about it. He was just jealous. That's all she said about it. He just does. She never mentioned his name, but she said something about Richard. I was talking about his name was Richard. I kept her name Richard. And I think that was his name. She referred to him as Richard, the Zodiac killer guy. She said he's really got a mean temper and that if he ever found out, he would...
So first, I'm not excited. I'm not happy. I'm not thrilled. I'm not proud. A lot of people in the comments are thinking that I'm proud. I am shocked. My jaw's on the floor, and I'm simply sharing information with you guys on the internet. That is it. Not proud. I'm indifferent. I don't feel any type of motherfucking way. Me and my grandpa did not have a relationship after the age of 9. I spent damn near every Christmas there at his house up until I was 9 when my father got custody of me. He would abuse my mother. He would abuse my grandmother and his children, my uncles as well. And I learned that later growing up in life. He hated my mother. He did not like my mother. And in turn, she eventually turned into an abuser herself. Moving forward, what else was there to answer? No DNA shit. I don't know. In terms of writing, I don't have any handwritten anything. I don't know if anyone searched the house for his belongings. Like I said, I am not close with my mother's side of the family after the age of 9. I'm now 35 years old. Here is a clip of my grandpa describing the scene of the night that he arrived of the Darlene Farron shooting. I think it's weird. He has a smirk on his face as he's describing the bra she was wearing. Here's a clip of Mike, the guy in the car, expressing what Darlene said as the Zodiac approached the car before shooting both of them. A little bit about me. I was a federal police officer for 10 years. I served in the United States Marine Corps as well, military police. That's my background in terms of law enforcement. I am no longer an officer. I medically resigned in April 2021. That's a little bit about me. I will be going live from Blue Rock Springs in Vallejo, California, the site of the Darlene Farron shooting. If you guys want to join, I made an event. It's in my bio. Please register. My grandpa was a Zodiac killer, part 3. If you have not seen parts 1 and 2, please, please go watch it. I want to start this one off by saying, once again, clarifying, this is not me glorifying my grandpa being a serial killer. This is not me excited and happy and pumped up, or as you guys would say in the comment section, flexing. I'm not flexing anything. I'm simply sharing information. I would assume that any human out there who discovered that their family member is possibly a serial killer is going to show some type of emotion. I don't know if you guys expect me to be crying or what. Anyway, today we're going to talk about a few things that also I connect as my grandpa being a motherfucker Zodiac killer. Number one is in his police report describing the Darlene Farron crime scene, he writes it out, and this is all in quotes, as you can see here on the screen. Pause to read. He writes it as if he's writing a poem, and we know that the Zodiac also wrote the fluidity of a poem. Another thing I'm going to tap on is the common misspellings in my grandpa's police reports and also common misspellings in the Zodiac writings. Although the only word that they spelled wrong was the word until with two L's, here's a list of both of the ways they spelled words. And a big one is like the double T's, or using E's with the ING word instead of dropping the E. My grandpa frequently did that. Something else about my grandpa. He was really horrible at spelling. He hated like crossword puzzles, but he really enjoyed math. And he also was a woodworker. That's what he would like spend a lot of time doing, going out, getting supplies, and spending time in a garage doing woodwork. Could this be a sign of like the coding and the cryptic messages of the Zodiac? Because the Zodiac was also bad at spelling. And also, my grandpa, as stated, was on the juvenile division wearing plain clothes in an unmarked car the night of the Darlene Farren shooting. And his area of operation was to patrol Blue Rock Springs and Lake Herman Road Lover's Ridge for teenagers doing the dirty birdie up in those little areas late at night. Well, he reported on the radio about 10 minutes before Darlene Farren's shooting that the area was clear and there were no vehicles. He also arrived on scene of the shooting 5 minutes after they found out about it and said that there was no cars. So he patrolled the area 10 minutes before the shooting, arrived 5 minutes after the shooting, and still reported not seeing any cars on the scene. If he already patrolled that area, wouldn't he have seen Darlene Farren and Mike parked in that parking lot? I don't know. A little suspicious. Aside from that, I'm excited to answer any of you guys' questions. Again, I have not taken this to the police. I've only known for 9 fucking days, and this shit has blown up. If you guys have any questions, please feel free to reach out to me. If you have any other information regarding Richard Hoffman being the Zodiac Killer, reach out, leave some comments. I'll see you guys on the next episode. My Grandpa Was the Zodiac Killer, Part 4. First and foremost, I wanted to come on here and apologize. In my first video I made a couple days ago, I used a really insensitive and volatile statement in describing one of the victims. There is no excuse for it, and I wanted to apologize to any of the victims and victims' families out there. I apologize. Moving forward with today's video, I suggest you guys get your motherfucking popcorn because I'm about to rock your socks off. If you haven't seen part 1, 2, and 3, I have a playlist up top. Go watch all of them. This shit gets crazy. So if you don't know, my grandpa Richard Hoffman was a Vallejo police officer, and I believe he was a Zodiac killer. So I found this poem written by the Zodiac, and in this poem, it uses the phrase "tit willow, tit willow, tit willow." Well, "tit willow" happens to be a song written by Mikado, and in that song lyrics, there happens to be a mention of Dickie Bird right here. Also, in this poem by Mikado, the "tit willow," that's the title of it, it states when describing a man who's passing away that he gargled out blood. If you watch this clip here from my grandfather giving a description of the scene, he uses the same type of statement. He was moaning and gargled out blood.
I looked down there, and here was a young guy down there laying on his back. Obviously, he'd been shot. He was reaching up towards me or the flashlight I was holding, kind of gurgling, obviously in pain.
I find that ironic. I may be reaching. You guys can draw the conclusion. "Tit Willow" is a song by Mikado where the word "Dickie Bird" is used. My grandpa's name is Richard, aka Dick. Let's get deeper into this letter. The autograph, the signature at the bottom, is obviously decoded and gibberish. Well, when you put these codes together, these little words and symbols, it just happens to spell the word Dick. Richard, is that you, Richie boy? Dick, hello? I don't know if I'm tripping. You guys tell me what you think about the way that this poem or letter is written by the Zodiac and how poetic it is, and also referencing Tit Willow and that's poetic nature. My grandpa's statement right here, describing the scene at Blue Rock Springs the night of Darlene Farren's murder and Mike McGow got shot. My grandpa uses poetic terminology the way he writes, describing the peacocks are singing and it was dark and the wind, the breeze was blowing across my face. My grandpa was a poet? Apparently, the way he describes these crime scenes. Leave a comment. Share this out.
What do you think? Honestly, I want to know what everybody thinks about that because I can't even believe it. Also, I can't believe how perfectly everything lines up, from the certain misspellings of things to the poemy type of writing to the way that the clips of him, like, he seems off and creepy. To the fact that, I mean, his name has been tossed around for years. I find it crazy that he passed away only 4 years ago, and his name has supposedly been tossed around for years, but no one looked into him. Like, unfortunately, unless there is some kind of DNA evidence, or he took some kind of a souvenir from the crime scenes and someone still is holding on to it, we'll never for 100% sure know that it was him. And I feel like it is kind of a bummer that no one really deep dived into this sooner, because again, he was alive up until 4 years ago. So I feel like we could have solved this case had someone looked into this a little closer or paid attention. I really think that if it is him, the way that he was able to get away with it was because he was a police officer. I mean, like, is that not the most obvious cover? On top of, again, he mentions in the third video, he was on patrol for cars that night. He reported that there were no cars 5 minutes before the murder, and then was on the scene within 10 minutes. Which is another thing I think is pretty darn suspicious and should have been something that they looked into. All of these different things, it's like, hello, red flag. It is like, I don't know, to me everything is just, it lines up so perfectly. And it is crazy to me that potentially after all these years, we are finally seeing the face of the Zodiac Killer. I really hope this guy takes this to the police and they really do an investigation. I also hope the police takes this seriously, but to be honest, at the time I'm filming this, which by the time I post this, it'll probably be a little bit longer, but he says that it was 9 days ago he found out about this and still has not taken it to police. So part of me is kind of wondering what's taking so long, because personally, I would be there like right away. I'd get all my research done and then like get there right away. I mean, I guess it's not like his grandpa's getting away any faster, but it's just, I'm so eager for like the possibility to see this case closed. I just have never been able to understand how for all these years, the Zodiac Killer has never been caught. To me, it's insane that he's gotten away with it for so long, but all of this makes perfect sense. But I really wish all this would have come to light just a few years sooner, where he could be questioned, although I doubt he'd tell the truth anyway. To me, it's crazy. If this is true, this is like, we're watching history unfold right here. Finally figuring out who the Zodiac Killer was. Our next TikTok is by the user Peter Petrella, and he shares a story about his very haunted hometown and an experience he had with a mimic. He said that he is originally from a small town in Pennsylvania that is incredibly haunted, but one day as a child, he is at his house, which is shockingly also haunted, and he hears his aunt calling his name, which is weird because his aunt lives in a completely different state and is not visiting them at the time, but he was a kid, so he went to go find his aunt, and he hears the voice coming from the basement. So he goes to try and find her, but his mom interrupts him and asks him what he's doing. He says he's looking for his aunt, to which she responds that she's not there.
I'm warning y'all now, this is a ghost story. If that's not your vibe, keep scrolling. If it is, hi, welcome. This is not a story that I've ever actually told publicly, but I think that if I tell this story, then maybe somebody will help me figure out what exactly I experienced. I think maybe I haven't told the story because it frightens me. I've been seeing an influx of people having supernatural encounters, and I just wanted to get mine into the world. Let me set the tone for you. Let me give you a location. I lived in a town called Ephrata, Pennsylvania. And if you haven't seen my hometown series, it's located right in Lancaster County, Pennsylvania. And a lot of weird happenings been going on there. Long story short, with the history of the town, in the early days, it was a very divided town. On one side of the town, we had a cult, not occult, a cult, a group of people called the Cloister who were preparing themselves for the afterlife. Again, I have a haunted hometown playlist. You can do it yourself. On the opposite side of town, we have a seance house, and the house at one point used to be a hospital. Then the hospital was bulldozed and it was turned into a Hampton Inn. And then smack in the middle of this town, we have an Indian burial ground. But a lot of people in this town are not making it past the age of like 25. Really, really creepy vibe. Walking around Ephrata feels like you have a cloud over your head. More so, it feels like you have a cloud over your head if you don't want to be there. There's a good bit of people who do love Ephrata, but they don't have any intention of leaving. Anybody that I've ever known that planned on moving out of their hometown and lived in Ephrata just felt so weighed down. And in a lot of the situations, those are the people who end up dying early. So this story takes place in my house, in my childhood home. And at this point, I want to say I was like 5 or 6 years old. And I've always been a very intuitive person. My dreams have often predicted things and still continue to do that in my life. You can believe it or you cannot believe it. I don't control your life. But on this one particular day, I heard my Aunt Lisa calling my name, which was very, very weird because Aunt Lisa did not live in my house. In fact, she lived in New Jersey, like an hour and a half away. But I was little and I heard my aunt and I was excited, so I wanted to go to her. So she's continuing to call my name, and it's like while I'm walking down my hallway. And the way my house is set up, it's my bedroom, my mom's bedroom, a hallway that leads down to like a staircase into the basement, and the basement was the most haunted place in my house. So in essence, the call was coming from my basement. So I walk out my bedroom door and I start to go towards the voice. And by sheer miracle, my mom opens her bedroom door. She's like, what are you doing? Where are you going? I said, oh, mom, and you didn't tell me Aunt Lisa was here. She goes, that's because she isn't. I said, but who is calling my name? My mom goes, oh, you know, you must have been imagining things. But I have thought about that since the day it happened. I can hear it clear as day in my head. I, like, remember it vividly like it was yesterday. So I don't know what happened. I don't know what I experienced. But that really rocked me for a very long time. I have many other paranormal stories, so if this is the vibe you want to look for a little while, just let me know and I'll, you know, do some more.
Okay, first of all, I'd like to know, if there's anyone watching this video from that town that he mentioned that he's from, let me know and let me know your experience. Is it, like he said, so interesting that there's like a whole town that has this like cursed vibe to it? But I think it is so frightening that he experienced what is, you know, known as a mimic. And the fact that his mom just so happened to save him at the right time before he went down into the basement, I mean, who knows what he would have experienced down there and what was trying to lure him to the basement. As was just confirmed by my Alexa, we have also now realized that Pennsylvania is in Appalachia, which makes this make a lot more sense. And the reason why I thought to even ask that was because I was going to say, if you think you hear someone calling your name, no, you didn't. And yes, that really, really applies here, especially when you're in Appalachia. If you hear someone calling your name that shouldn't be calling your name, that shouldn't be in your house at the time, no, you didn't. This is, if nothing else, a lesson of minding your own business when something strange is happening. If something happens, no, it didn't. If you hear something, no, you didn't. I am just, you know, incredibly grateful that his mom stopped him before anything bad could have happened, because, I mean, who knows? Now, the final four TikToks of this video are by the same user. And if you saw a few videos ago, I shared a bunch of TikToks where people told stories of unexplainable things that they saw. One of these videos, a woman shared about her time meeting a vampire while she was driving for Lyft. And that inspired this user, EssenceCreations27, to share her experience driving rideshare in Chicago and running into vampires. I'm just gonna play you the original first video and we will debrief from there.
There's a lady on TikTok talking about her encounter with vampires, so I might as well talk about mine. This New Year's Eve, I was driving Lyft and I picked up an order, and it ended up being at like a place that used to be a church, but it wasn't a church anymore, obviously, if you saw the festivities that was going on. There were like people with cloaks and like dark hair and heavy eyeliner, and there was like a red glow from the building coming out. Four guys got into my car. As soon as they got into the car, I felt a chill. And yes, it was winter, but it was a different kind of chill. I turned around and looked at them, and I immediately knew they were vampires. And it wasn't even just like a thought. It was more so annoying. Before they got into the car, I was thinking like maybe they were devil worshippers, because I had seen like a goat head and like the typical symbols that you see with associated with that. But I was like, no, these are vampires. There were two brunettes and two blondes. They all had blue eyes. Not that that mean anything, but their eyes were almost hypnotically blue. They were so clear. You could see through their, like, not their soul, but I can't even describe it. Their skin was white, but not white like crayon white, but it was very pale. But it was not a pale, like, you know, some like white people are like, oh, I'm so pale. Even like red people with red hair, how pale. It was still a different kind of pale, because even regular people, when they're pale, there's still some warmness to their skin. Like their skin looked cold. I don't know how to describe it, but it was more so the feeling of me knowing. Immediately, I start to panic. My heart is racing. I'm feeling like, is it too late to reject a call? Like, can I even ask them to leave the vehicle? And then I started thinking, okay, if I am panicking and my blood pressure is rising, then I'm like pushing more blood through my veins, which may mean that I may seem more appetizing to them. This is all stuff that's going through my mind. The man behind me, the blonde who was like in the middle, touches my shoulder, and immediately it's like somebody poured warm honey over me. Like that is the calm just spreading down my body. It was like immediately I felt relaxed, almost like I was in a trance kind of there, but like watching myself. I can't even really describe it. And I knew at that moment that I wasn't necessarily in danger. So then the guy is like, well, our car is only a few blocks away, which I could tell from looking at the app. And he's like, but before we get there, we need you to answer a question, and you have to think very carefully about this. So now I'm like, okay, this answer is going to determine if I go home to my children or not. And it could just be my imagination and like me jumping the gun, and he could have been joking, but it didn't feel jokey. So he's like, okay, well, we have two separate cars. How would you group us together? Who should ride with who? What? So I'm like, I look back at them, and they're smiling and they're kind of giggling. Now their teeth don't look like regular teeth, but they don't look like the typical vampire teeth either. But they definitely did not look like human teeth. Their canines were a little bit more pronounced, but not in a dramatic fake way. I can't even freaking describe it. And actually, if I had to describe them, to sketch them out right now, I couldn't even, because it's like they're a memory, but not like a typical memory, like a memory behind a memory. I can't describe it. But anyways, I knew it. I'm like, you're vampires. Yes. I heard the answer in my head. No, I'm looking at them through the, because I'm like, if they lunge for jugular, I'm going to crush us all. But I grouped the opposite hair colors together. And the guy said, well, why'd you do that? I said, I don't know. It just felt right. He said, excellent choice. He took out his phone and he's like, I'm going to start my car now. And I'm like, you can start your car from my car. And he's like, yeah, but we like you. You'll get home safe. Good. Like, you'll get home safe tonight. Have a good night. And I was like, yeah, I was kind of thinking that, you know, doing Lyft on New Year's Eve could be dangerous because, like, who knows what kind. I was trying to make it seem like I didn't think they were the danger, but just let them know, like, in case they heard me panicking. Oh, fucking went and saw the vampire. But anyways, they got out and they gave me my biggest tip of the night. You would think that would have been my last ride for the night, but no, I kept going. I made it home, and I didn't tell any other person about this story because, like, are you supposed to share vampire stories? I don't know. However, I just did, so just know that there are other beings in this world besides us, and maybe they're not all so dangerous.
One thing that really sticks out to me is how she says it was, like, a knowing that they're vampires. It wasn't just like, oh, like, these people are, like, they kind of look like vampires. It's like she knew. On top of the fact that this guy has the ability to just, like, calm her down by putting his hand on her shoulder, very, very similar to the original story that I told you a few videos ago. But to me, the you'll make it home safe tonight part was incredibly eerie. I mean, obviously, good to know, but that's just a very eerie comment to make to someone if you are a normal human. I don't think I would ever say that to someone. Because also, how am I supposed to know? But that's really creepy that it's like, it's acting as if I have any decision over whether or not they're going to make it home. But, you know, the vampires may have that decision. Or the foresight to let you know that you're going to make it home safely. Because they can see into the future. I don't know. In parts 2 and 3, which will be our final 2 TikToks of today's video, she goes on to answer some questions and debunk the people who are saying that they were either just goth, or that they were at that event last night, or that they were at that event on New Year's Eve, and that it was a goth rave, and they were just goth people and not vampires. And she goes on to debunk this and say they did not look like all the other goth attendees. They were very, like, put together in, like, a suit and looked like old money. And she was actually calmed by seeing them walk up to the car until they got in, and she felt the energy shift.
So yesterday I posted a video about how I met 4 vampires New Year's Eve in Chicago. And I want to respond to a lot of comments I had, because I described the scene when I pulled up to the location, which was a church that has obviously been revamped to be some kind of event space. And everyone's like, oh, you thought they were vampires because they were goth? Because I said that when I pulled up, like, people had on dark cloaks and, like, makeup, and, like, people had a goat head on a stick, and I saw people, like, carrying, like, the 6-point stars. And so I was like, damn, did I pull up on some devil worshipers or something? That's initially what I thought. That does not mean that the 4 men that got into my car looked like that. They were not dressed goth at all. They did not look like those people. In fact, they stuck out like a sore thumb. In fact, they weren't, like, standing there when I first pulled up. When I first pulled up, I checked the scene. And that's when I was like, damn, should I leave? Because I don't know what's going on here. This look crazy. But when they walked up and I saw them just in regular clothes, looking like old money, actually, I felt a sense of relief. Because I was like, oh, okay. These motherfuckers, like, they weren't even a part of this. So it wasn't until they got in the car and I felt the energy shift. And then I didn't even really, when I felt the energy shift, I still just, you know, start, like, pushed the ride and went on a ride. But one of them sat next to me, 3 of them sat behind me. And that's kind of when I really started looking like, well, I didn't know what that feeling was. Like, the first initial feeling, it could have been like, are they schmurderers? Like, but then it was like a gut instinct that just, like, inside was like, these are vampires. And then the more, like, now I'm studying and I'm looking at them because I'm freaking out. So, let me start off by saying, I'm from the north side of Chicago. I don't know if y'all know anything about the north side of Chicago, but we have Belmont. We have any kind of person you could possibly think of. So, I'm very familiar with the goth community and what they look like and that whole aesthetic. In fact, the high school I went to had a goth community.
The guys in my car were not goth. I'm going to say this and I'm going to let it go. There are over 480 views that have been on my video of when I met the four vampires on New Year's Eve. And over 2,000 comments. And a lot of those comments are people saying that they were there at the event. It was a rave. It was a goth party, etc. Who have not come on there? The four guys to go on there and be like, oh no, we are not vampires. Until they come on here and say, no, we're not vampires, I know they're vampires. It's not about me thinking. It's not about me feeling any type of way. I know they're vampires. I also know that vampires can party with whoever they want to party with. Who gonna stop them? Just because it was a rave and a goth party, y'all think vampires can't come? I'm sure they go to the movies too. I'm sure they go lots of different places. And truthfully, if I was a vampire, I would probably hang with the goth and emo community a lot more, because one thing about that community is they are not very judgmental. They are all generally friendly and like accepting people. And I could walk in looking like old money with my pale skin and my strange eyes, and ain't nobody really gonna think nothing. Because these guys weren't dressed goth. They weren't dressed for the thing. They was dressed like I want my sugar daddy to be dressed if I ever get one. It's obvious that a lot of people are just not tapped into their inner knowing. For instance, I could see a person in plain clothing doing plain clothes shit and know they're a police officer. I have been in close proximity with people and knew right away without them doing or saying anything that my children were not safe around them, that they were schmetterschmiles. I don't know if you could say the pedo word on here without causing controversy. It's an energy. It's an energy that these people have. And their energy told my spirit, vampire. Because they weren't even looking goth. They were giving Lucky Blue Smith, Nara Smith's husband. Okay. And I could barely sleep last night. After commenting to y'all on that video, and when I pressed to read the comments, the video keep playing, I ended up scaring the shit out of myself. It was like I was reliving it.
All I'm gonna say is I believe her. Again, I know it sounds a little crazy. Like, out of so many rides I'm sure she's done, the fact that this stuck with her so much and she wanted to tell people about it, I feel like is testament enough. But again, like I said in the video where I covered all of these types of stories, come on, like, you can't tell me that there's not a possibility of, you know, vampires or werewolves, and I know I sound crazy, but there's not a possibility of them existing when there are 8 billion people in the world. There are too many people for that to not even be a slight possibility. I guess that is where I will leave this video today. Let me know any thoughts you have about the TikToks I have presented here for you today. Let me know which ones were your favorite, and if you ever stumble across any terrifying TikToks you'd like me to include in another video, feel free to tag me in them. I really do appreciate your guys' help on coming up with these terrifying TikToks. My links are down below, so you can check me out there to be able to tag me. If you guys like this video, please be sure to give it a big thumbs up. If you did like this video, I will be popping up a couple of recommendations for similar videos you should also check out. If you're new here, please click the subscribe button down below or right here and turn my post notifications so you never miss a video. I post every Sunday and sometimes Wednesday at 2 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Thank you guys so much for watching. Again, I really hope you enjoyed this video, and I will see you next time.